whoever is food insecure is not sure where their next meal is coming from.
Food insecurity refers to the USDA's measure of lack of consistent access to enough food for an active, healthy life. In 2015, an estimated 1 in 8 Americans were food insecure. That's 42 million Americans, including 13 million children. In addition to federal nutrition programs such as SNAP and WIC, food insecure households often depend on local food pantries to put food on the table. However, local food pantries sometimes struggle to meet demand and to provide a variety of food options. On today's Sound Living, a K-State Research and Extension Nutrition Specialist offers tips for donating to local food pantries. Sound Living is a weekly public affairs program produced by Research and Extension at Kansas State University. I'm Jeff Wichman. Sandy Proctor says food pantries, in one form or another, have been around for a long time and serve a vital need in their communities.
I think food pantries have been in place for as long as there were people considering their neighbors' welfare. We just recently started one here at Kansas State University with a student focus because we know that many of our students are unable to eat regularly. So any place where there is a group of people, likely there are going to be folks who are food insecure and occasionally needing help.
You mentioned that food insecurity, and that really is something that is widespread and probably will continue to be widespread.
Right. It simply means that whoever is food insecure is not sure where their next meal is coming from. That doesn't necessarily mean that they can't get food, but is it in an acceptable way? Like, you know, if they routinely, say, dumpster dive outside of a restaurant to get some of those perfectly good leftovers that got thrown away, is that considered socially acceptable? Are they food secure? Or let's say that the only way that my family would be able maybe to have enough to eat is that I have to plan on me as the mother skipping meals so that my children have enough to eat, or that my children routinely eat with relatives a certain number of nights a week because I simply cannot put enough food on the table to feed my family. So whatever those situations might be, and there's a million of them, it means that the participant, the people, the family are not able to feel confident that they know where that next meal is coming from.
We tend to think about the donations to these food pantries as we get closer to the holidays, but this is a year-round issue, and these food pantries are handing out food, I would imagine, every day.
Oh, you have to think about that. If you have a family of four and your kids eat school meals most of the time in the summer, you're going to be more food insecure than you are during the school year if they don't take part in those summer feeding programs, which is another real emphasis that has been made recently to combat hunger in growing children. And we work hard, and Kansas is really making a difference in offering some of those summer food programs out across the state where school children have a chance to have that same healthy meal that's offered during the school year through the summertime so that they don't have that three-month period of real likely hunger. So if you have a situation like that where, you know, you're thinking that hunger is seasonal, we are all challenged to think again because I think we've seen posters, I know I have, that say hunger knows no season. It really doesn't, and it doesn't have a lot of what you'd think of as hard, fast boundaries either. It can be very fluctuational. It can be very situational. It can happen at the end of month routinely for people whose paycheck doesn't quite stretch as far as their family's need to eat does. And so that inability to make food stretch is where pantries have always stepped up to the plate.
Along those lines, then, what should we be thinking about in terms of food donations to the food pantries? I know there are some do's and some don'ts.
Well, I would like to have people consider, if you were in that situation, what type of food would you like to be able to get? Do you want outdated food that somebody has cast off of their shelf, or something that maybe is dented or is a very narrow offering of green beans or corn or chicken noodle soup? Those are fine things, but are there more things that we can think of, a wider variety of healthful choices that are in good shape, that are not poised to go out of date on the label, but that offer really healthful, nutritious food to whoever the recipient is, just as though we would want to happen for our family if we were in that situation.
There are a number of things that we look at in terms of really just trying to follow the MyPlate guidelines. If you're thinking about donating, you really should follow those guidelines.
That would be a great place to start. If you are going to provide maybe ready meals or some of the kits that are there, think about offering a bag of pasta that's whole grain, or beyond just canned corn and green beans, maybe canned beans themselves that could be used in a really healthful soup or stew or chili. Some of those choices might be really good choices to start with, but to really think about other things that might be available. Maybe shelf-stable milk products would be really welcome as well. And it depends on your local pantry, what kinds of foods they can hold and what kinds of equipment they have for gathering up donations. Or it could be that a well-planned cash donation might help them buy, say, fresh bread or obtain fresh bread for distribution. That could be whole grain bread that might be available to pantry customers when they come through.
That's one of the problems that we kind of face, is the fact that some of these things need to be able to stay on the shelf for a longer period of time, whereas there are certain times of the season where they can maybe turn that food over in 2 or 3 days, and then they can take fresh vegetables, the fresh fruits.
And it really does depend on what the resources are of the pantry that you're working with. They may have refrigerated cases that can accept refrigerated items for distribution, or they may have to go out and purchase those on a regular basis, and so cash donations would be really welcome. Fresh produce may be something that is offered at the pantry, or they may have some sort of situation worked out with a local grocery store where the person coming through the pantry gets a voucher or something for fresh vegetables or fruit. It's not cash, but it is able to be exchanged for those items at the store.
Is protein a problem because it seems like meat products could be an issue?
It can be, and that's another really good thing to think about when you're making a contribution to a pantry. There are so many shelf-stable items now that are really high quality. If you think about the pouches of, say, tuna or salmon or chicken or turkey that are available, they're shelf-stable, they have a long life, but the quality of those is very nice, and it can be made easily into sandwich filling or to extend a casserole or a main dish or a soup. And so as we think of things to contribute to the pantry, a protein item is, as we know, one of the more expensive things that people will have to buy with their food budget and may often be the nutrient that is lacking in a healthy diet.
You mentioned the vegetables before, and I was noticing that one of the recommendations was the low-sodium varieties. Mm-hmm. If you're picking something up off the shelf, maybe look in some of those directions.
Well, it just makes good sense. We know that most Americans could benefit from eating less salt. And if we are having to depend on a lot of foods that aren't prepared fish that may be processed in nature, they're probably going to have more salt in them. And so if we can mix that amount of sodium with maybe some very wisely purchased lower sodium canned products, just the easy ones to get, vegetables and tomatoes and soups, some of those things historically very high in salt, but by purchasing the lower salt ones, we can actually assist some of our pantry recipients in carefully adhering to some of the diet restrictions that many people need to follow, but especially the lower income audience oftentimes struggles with hypertension.
We often think of families when we think of the food pantry recipients, but there are also singles who are taking part. So maybe some of those things that are individualized that can be prepared for just one person.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. Some of the smaller cans or smaller servings, smaller boxes, packaging of things might be very useful for people because sometimes, and there is no way to generalize here, but sometimes the audience who uses the pantry may not have ample storage space for refrigeration themselves, or it may be a simple need to get something, heat it, and eat it rather quickly. So that is definitely something to take into consideration. I think offering a variety of those sizes, the very large ones for the bigger families and some of those single sizes, would be most welcome.
I know some people may want to donate their homed canned goods. They may want to donate their chili. That's really something that you really can't do.
No. You know, it's kind of like preparing food for large groups. We need to build in extra steps to assure safety. So pantries can't accept home canned products, and they need to be very careful when they consider even gardened products. If you have a garden and you can assure them of the growing conditions or a community garden that is able to supply produce to a pantry, the source of that needs to be considered carefully because it can certainly be helpful or it can be a risk that's too big to take.
One thing that people might consider is just organizing food drives. That can be something that will really benefit a lot of people and really help out the food pantry.
And again, I would encourage a couple of things. The first one would be have that conversation with your local pantry to see what types of foods, what types of items they might need. It could be that they need infant formula. It could be that they need pet food. We think about food for people, but when you think about it, a lot of people who are in dire straits, maybe homeless or nearly homeless, certainly can't afford pet food. And so sometimes those are welcome additions at a pantry, but you really need to check it out. Another thing that is kind of like what we always talk about around our family at Christmas time, you know, it's one size fits all. Most pantries can use cash to purchase, whether it's fresh products or things that they need to go with particular food boxes. Like I know here in Manhattan around the holidays, they'll use cash contributions to supplement some of the turkey boxes at holiday time and stuff. Some of those things have to be purchased. They're not donated. And so typically cash is a great contribution to offer your pantry.
And if you really want to get to understand what's going on in your community, spend some time volunteering at the local food pantry.
I have several times filled those holiday boxes and then helped distribute them before Thanksgiving and Christmas. And you know, you'd like to think maybe that it's a small activity, but actually it's huge and it's amazing and it's a well-oiled machine for the many, many, many boxes that go out at holiday time. And so it does take a lot of volunteer time and effort, and all sorts of people are welcome. Those with brute strength to lift and carry, but not only that, people who are willing to sort, people who are willing to mark boxes ahead of time, people who are willing to make cards or calls to people and solicit some of those contributions early on. Volunteerism around the food pantry at holiday time, but really any time, is always welcome.
And as you mentioned, this is a situation that is probably not going to change drastically anytime soon. We're always going to have people who are food insecure, and they need that resource.
And that's why I think we would really like to encourage that people consider, we all know that all foods can fit, and an occasional high-fat or high-sodium food is not going to, you know, destroy somebody's health. But what we need to consider is that some people will be utilizing a pantry for longer than any of us, including them, would like to. So let's think about making those offerings to the pantry as healthful as we possibly can to assure that those who receive the food are getting as much benefit from it as we would hope.
As you mentioned, check in your local communities to find out what may be offered there. We also have a publication through K-State Research and Extension that has a lot of information on this.
It's a great fact sheet that was developed by our food safety specialist, Londa Nautike. And she works with Kansas State University and also the University of Missouri. So this fact sheet and leader's guide is really available through each extension office in the state. And it would be a really good tool for advising those contributions, but also for starting conversations around local pantry needs and how those might be obtained through working actively through the community.
That's K-State Research and Extension Nutrition Specialist Sandy Proctor. More information on health and nutrition is available at county and district extension offices and on the extension website, www.ksre.ksu.edu. Sound Living is a weekly public affairs program produced by Research and Extension at Kansas State University. I'm Jeff Wichman, and this is the K-State Radio Network.